How y'all doing? It's good to be
here.
How
are you?
Good to see you. We are, I'm just here, I'm taking our moderator. Originally, Bruce Conk had a health emergency, so I'm kind of stepping in. So if I, hopefully I won't step in it, but if I'm fumbling around, that's why. It's kind of last minute. Now, the questions that we're going to be asking tonight, I did not put together. They were put together by citizens in the community, so I'm just going to be asking them. Our format tonight will be, we'll start with an opening, a two-minute opening statement from each candidate, and then I will ask them questions, and they get up to 3 minutes on each question to answer, and they don't have to take the whole time, and we're going to work through the series of questions that we have that you've submitted. How many people in the audience submitted a question? Anybody here? A couple people, okay. So that's the way it'll go, and we'll run us until we get at least an hour or until we get through all the questions, whichever comes first, I guess. So thank you for coming. Thank you for being concerned about your community. Okay, opening statements, Mr. Sargent.
First off, I'd like to tell everybody thank you for coming out, and also thank you to the Chamber of Commerce for putting this event on. I'm Corey Broussard. I'm a long-life resident of this parish. I've been a law enforcement officer for 18 years.
Could you speak up just a little bit, please?
Sure. Would you like me to start over?
If you like, yeah.
Okay, first off, I'd like to thank everybody here for taking time out of their day, and also the Broadbridge Chamber of Commerce for putting this event on. Apparently, we're not the only ones that see how important this is to our parish. My name is Corey Broussard. I am a candidate. I'm also a lifelong resident of this parish. I've been a law enforcement officer for 18 years, a private investigation case manager for the last 2 years. I've done 4 years overseas training police officers. And I'd just like to say, you know, everyone needs to see what's going on around us. It's very important to all of us. And not just those of us sitting here, but to our families at home.
Thank you again. I'd like to start off by thanking everybody for coming here and supporting the forum. I'd like to thank the chamber for putting it together and organizing it. Dr. Cross for it moderating. I am Buzz LeBlanc. With your support, I am the next sheriff of St. Martin Parish. I'm born in Broadbridge. I was born on Potter Street right across the bayou here. I went to St. Bernard. I was a crusader. Broadbridge High, and then on to USL, where I got a bachelor's degree in education. Upon graduation, I joined the United States Navy and spent 20 years as a naval officer on cruisers and destroyers. Upon retirement, I returned to Broadbridge and got a job with the St. Martin Parish Sheriff's Office. For 5 years, I worked in corrections, and I was a narcotics agent. I left the sheriff's office to further my education. I went, at this time, back to University of Louisiana in Lafayette and got a master's degree in history. And about the same time, I met my wife, Angel Angel LeBlanc from Cecilia. And we've been in business, a successful business, for the last 13 years. And here I am again, back in Broadbridge, and I'm standing before you today telling you that I'm here to restore your faith in law enforcement in St. Martin Parish. Again, with your help and your support, I will be the next sheriff of St. Martin Parish. Thank you.
Mr. Terry.
Thank you, everybody, for coming out. I'm born and raised here in Broadbridge, a lifelong resident of St. Martin Parish. Went to Broadbridge High School, graduated in 81. Went on to work in the oil field for a couple of years and got laid off. Went to work for the sheriff's office and stayed there for 19 years. Throughout the years I was there, I was able to work with various departments. I worked with patrol, canine, narcotics detectives. It was a learning experience. I learned a lot. And I got married to my wife, Angela. We have 5 kids total. We own and operate a business in St. Martinville. Been there for a little over 12 years now since my departure from the sheriff's office in 2003. Thank everybody for coming out. We've got a lot of changes that I'd like to see done. It's going to bring the department back to the people, bring the trust back, and so we can get the criminal element out of our parish and make it safer for our kids, our families, and our friends.
All right, thank you. And then the first question goes to Mr. LeBlanc. Right, we'll go with you. Why do you want to run for sheriff, and what skills or abilities set you apart from the other candidates?
Well, I believe that it's time for a change in the leadership in St. Martin Parish. I think it's time that we restore a sense of trust and confidence in the sheriff's office. I feel like I'm uniquely qualified. I have 20 years of military service. That's leadership and management training that you can get nowhere in the world. I have 5 years law enforcement, 1 year in corrections, and 4 years as a narcotics officer. My business experience, 12 years. I've managed payrolls, budgets, customer satisfaction. And remember, in private business, there is no tax base to fall back on. The sheriff's office is one of the biggest businesses in St. Martin Parish, and if you don't run it as such, you're going to cost the taxpayers money. We have a lot of problems here. We have property crimes. We have narcotics is running rampant. We don't have adequate facilities to house offenders. We need a budget allocation to support additional pay for deputies and to add additional deputies into service. I want to be your agent for change in St. Martin Parish. I want to be the leader that makes a difference. I want to restore your trust and confidence in the St. Martin Parish Sheriff's Office. Thank you.
Mr. Terrio, same question. I'll repeat it if you like.
Yes. I was born and raised here. All of my family's here. We've got 5 kids between me and my wife, Angela. Got 1 grandchild and 1 on the way right now. So it's very important to me to make this parish safe for my family, your family, and people that would want to move here and make a life here in St. Martin Parish. My 19 years with the sheriff's office, I've worked with numerous departments, gained a lot of knowledge in how everything works, what needs to be done, how it's done. I have worked in my own business for 12 years now. I've done management, had to deal with dealing with the payrolls, the whole aspect of business, which it's very difficult in these days and times. I'm sure Buzz can say the same with the economy like it is. You know, it's very hard to keep a business going, so it takes a lot of skill and to get it, to keep it going. Throughout the years, like I said, I've worked with juvenile detective narcotics. I've worked with local and surrounding agencies on many cases, and it's something that we have to do, establish the relationship between the public, the sheriff's office, and the surrounding agencies, so we can work together and solve the crimes, listen to what the people have to say, and help them to have the confidence to come to the sheriff's office when they do have a problem and get something done to, you know, solve their problems and fix what needs to be done.
Thank you. Mr. Broussard, same question.
Yes, sir, please.
Question is, why do you want to run for sheriff, and what skills and abilities do you have that set you apart from the other candidates?
Initially, I didn't want to run for the position of sheriff. It was actually never a thought. After 18 years of law enforcement and 4 years overseas doing police missions, when I came home, I decided I wanted to expand into the field of private investigation. 2 years as a manager with great pay and a different type of enforcement, I was able to spend more time with my family on the evenings and the weekends. However, spending that extra time at night with my family and on weekends, I started to observe things around my community and my neighborhood. I started to observe there was no units passing my community, much less my neighborhood. As time elapsed, I noticed more criminal activity in our parish with ineffective enforcement services. Protection with no resolution to the issues. Then I actually realized while I was overseas there was a couple of key issue services that had actually disappeared. At one time, the former administration had actually diminished criminal activity and they were just gone. There was no logical explanation. Through more time, I started hearing from residents who expressed their displeasures with coming across some of our law enforcement we have here today. One of the biggest things that I kept hearing was they can get no help. For me as a law enforcement officer, that is very disturbing, because there's not one reason why when a law enforcement law enforcement officer is called, he cannot assist you. Some way, somehow, he can provide some kind of resolution to why you called him. Then I made the decision. If the current administration could not help the people, I was going to run, win, remove the political influence, and hold our sheriff's office to a higher standard. Getting out there and showing our deputies how to treat the people, how to provide them with law enforcement services by being proactive, professional, and courteous. What sets me apart from the other candidates, I have the knowledge, ability, and determination to make a difference in enforcement in the way our parish receives it. By oath, I will always be available. By principle, I stand by the words to uphold the law. Without political influence, lastly, I'm not a boss confined to four walls of the office. I'm a leader. My boots go on like any other deputy out there, and I will be out there with those deputies. I cannot speak for anyone but myself when I say this. I'm tired of hearing the same old promises that we've heard in the past. I'm ready to put words into action and give the people of our community the enforcement services and protection that they deserve.
Thank you. And we start this next round with Mr. Terrio. Mr. Terrio, it was reported that the crime rate in the parish is down 45%. Do you agree with this report, or you disagree with this report?
I disagree. I've been doing a lot of door-to-door walking throughout this campaign, talking to a lot of citizens, and more we're hearing more about, you know, property crime, thefts, burglaries in the neighborhoods, and when they call the sheriff's office, they take 45 minutes to get there, and then they can't help them, and it's a the residents speak loud enough for everything. I mean, I don't know what statistics are, but to hear what the residents have to say is what means the most, because they are the people that will cast a vote for a sheriff, and they will depend on us to take care of them in the long run. So I don't feel that it has dropped at all.
Okay, Mr. Broussard, same question.
I cannot agree with the number, as that was a number generated by our sheriff's office, and as to date, it has not been provided to the Louisiana Commission on Law Enforcement or the FBI for their criminal stats for the year of 2014. However, I personally have noticed an increase in unresolved criminal activity in my neighborhood, community, and the parish this past year. According to uniform crime stats reported by LCLE for the year 2013, crime in our parish has decreased in certain categories, and in other categories it has increased. Just two of them, robbery saw an increase of 28%, burglary saw an increase of 8%. However, the number of 45% comes from the crime reporting. That doesn't mean criminals stop reporting, committing crime. It could mean that people stop reporting the crimes to their agencies because they feel that our agency doesn't have the ability to properly investigate these crimes being committed. So no, sir, I do not agree with that.
Okay, Mr. LeBlanc.
No, absolutely not. It's absurd. Where does this figure come from? Where is the basic data for this allegation? Who validated this data? Are these crimes being reported properly? These are questions that we need answers. I was hoping to get the answers today to these questions at the forum, but the source isn't present. I know in traveling throughout the parish that no one that I have spoken to believes that this 45% reduction is the case. Property and narcotics crimes are running rampant with little resolution. I continually hear from parish residents that either they, a neighbor, or a relative have been touched by these crimes with little resolution by law enforcement. Some residents have been victimized numerous times. Nearly every section of the parish has been plagued by multiple crimes. The feedback that I've received from throughout the parish does not support this claim that there is a 45% reduction in crime in St. Martin Parish. Thank you.
Thank you, and we move on to a different question with Mr. Broussard. Mr. Broussard, it has been said that St. Martin Parish is the warehouse for thieves from the surrounding parishes. How would you change this perception? And secondly, what will you do to make St. Martin Parish a place where criminals know not to stop?
First off, in reference to St. Martin Parish being known as a warehouse, I have every intention of making it known as sheriff that if you commit a crime in our parish, I will accommodate you by bringing you to justice, providing you with three meals, a cell, and a roommate for the entirety of your criminal sentence. However, I will provide the necessary tools needed to attempt to rehabilitate you and set you free back in society. And hopefully that will be the last time you will be in our parish jail or any other parish jail. Through proactive enforcement, deterring criminal activity, and aggressive stance on apprehension of those responsible for committing crimes in our communities, this will make a criminal think twice, knowing that our sheriff's office will go through lengths to ensure justice is served upon them. I believe with increased patrol in our communities, the reestablishment of highway and addiction, positive community policing, this will reduce criminal activity in our parish.
Okay, thank you, Mr. LeBlanc. Same question?
Did you repeat the question?
Yeah, I'll repeat it. Hang on one second. It has been said that St. Martin Parish is the warehouse for thieves from the surrounding parishes. How would you change this perception? And secondly, what would you do to make St. Martin Parish a place where criminals know not to stop?
Well, I don't think it's a perception. I think it's a reality. And the reality is going to get us. I believe that the criminal element from the surrounding parishes throughout the state, people that drive by on the interstate realize that if you commit a criminal activity in St. Martin Parish, it's unlikely you'll get caught. And if you get caught, it's unlikely you'll get punished. And if you get punished, it probably won't be very much. And looking at it from that perspective, why wouldn't we be the shopping mall for the rest of the state and the parishes around here? I think what we need to do is we need more deputies. We need more patrols. We need, again, highway interdiction. We need to get more people on the road, get more. When a crime is committed, we need to do a more intense investigation than we're getting done now. Even when the crimes are investigated, no one seems to get arrested. It doesn't matter how much evidence. They appear to have some aversion for taking fingerprints. They seem to have some aversion for getting DNA samples. It almost seems to me that they don't want to catch them. And I don't know what the reason is. Maybe it's because of the lack of jail space. Maybe it's, in any case, whatever the reason, the job isn't getting done here. And we need to get the job done before it gets worse than it is already. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Terrio. Same question.
Can you repeat it?
Sure. It has been said that St. Martin Parish is the warehouse for thieves from the surrounding parishes. How would you change this perception? And secondly, what will you do to make St. Martin Parish a place where criminals know not to stop?
Let's start off with enforcing the laws, investigating the crimes, whether they're big or small. I mean, arresting the offenders, bringing them to justice, and presenting solid cases to the DA's office that's going to allow them to prosecute the criminals and get the maximum sentence out of them. Working with the DA's office is key to getting this done. We do need to add more patrols, and what we can pick up as patrolmen in the sheriff's office, bring the cases to a close with the right evidence, and get these cases solved, convicted, convict the felons or the offenders. The people will learn that St. Martin Parish is not a place to come and commit a crime, because once they learn that we're no longer going to take what they're giving us, they're going to stop coming.
Okay. Thank you. Moving on to a new question. And this question goes to Mr. LeBlanc first. Some surrounding parishes offer higher wages for experienced deputies. This has resulted in some experienced deputies leaving for neighboring parishes. What is your plan to retain good experienced deputies, and do you have any plan to increase wages as part of that effort?
Well, I think increasing wages is definitely part of the solution. Now, this is an ongoing problem, not only with St. Martin Parish, with other parishes. There are other parishes that pay less than St. Martin, and so people from those parishes come here, and then they get experience and training, and then they move on to a parish with that pays more. But that's not the whole issue. I think part of the problem is, if you like where you are and you like your job and you're getting compensated correctly for it, you still might leave. if you're not allowed to do your job. If you're a deputy and you're trained to do a job and you're working in a place where you're being held back and not being able to do your job to your full capability, that's a problem. You don't have job satisfaction. So yeah, they need a pay raise. We need more deputies to reduce the workload. But we also have to give them a better working environment. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Terrio, same question.
First, we'd start with make the working environment much better. The working environment within the sheriff's office is very volatile. Deputies have to have a comfortable place to come to work where they don't have to worry about the day-to-day run-ins and just do their job and not have to worry about the politics of the office. It seems to be something that comes up quite often. Offer a better wage and benefit package that would comparable to the local agencies. That's one of the biggest issues that I hear coming from the department is deputies leaving because of the pay, because of the situation where the administration is running the office. If it would be much easier to work there and you'd be able to do your job, we'd have a better department as a whole.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Broussard. Same question.
Competitive pay and how you treat employees will determine the agency's ability to retain experienced and dedicated deputies. Alike, you will have officers that will come and go, it's a turnover rate. Once they gain experience, they'll move on for better pay. However, the biggest issue in sheriff's offices is a good old boy system. It has to go. It's ruining the good deputies that are there, and if they are good, they will turn bad within a matter of years or move on to do something else. The removal of the system will encourage other employees that are there to perform better as they feel they will have the ability to move up and assuming better paying roles. I firmly believe promotion or raise is warranted based on an individual's performance and ability to assume more responsibility, not from the sheer fact that he's a buddy or a friend.
Okay, thank you. And we move on to the next question. We're going to start with Mr. Terrio this time. Question is, and you mentioned this in one of your previous responses, how will you work with the district attorney's office to prosecute criminals once they've been arrested? What are you going to do different than the current administration is doing?
I feel the need to work real closely with the DA's office. I mean, they're the key to getting the criminals off. Once we arrest them, they go through the process. And if we don't have the right investigative people to do everything the way it needs to be done properly and turn over a well-investigated case with good solid evidence to the DA's office, you can arrest criminals all day. If it's not right when it's time to go to court, the DA can't prosecute, and therefore the criminals just walk back out onto the street. That's the biggest issue I see with it, is not having the right investigative people trained in investigation the right way to do their job and present the cases for prosecution.
Thank you, Mr. Attorney. Mr. Broussard, same question.
First off, I'd like to say whoever submitted that question, you just identified a problem. This process has been in effect in the 16th JDC since 2011. The current district attorney is the one who started in Iberia Parish. I was currently working for Iberia Parish Sheriff's Office at the time. This is a very crucial part of the judicial process, and like I said, it should be occurring every week, not only for investigative cases where arrests were made, but for cases where arrests had not been made. There may have been pending statements, evidence lab results, lack of evidence to support a criminal charge in the case at the time. However, the district attorney not only prosecutes a case, they assist with the investigative process to ensure that an individual who is charged for a crime is charged under the appropriate law. Majority of the criminal laws of this state are broad, and the slightest detail missed by an investigator could lead in a lesser charge or dismissal of a case. The district attorney's office ensures that the person charged with the crime is being brought forth under the appropriate charge for a criminal act being committed. And I'm going to repeat this again. This has been in place since 2011.
So. Thank you, Mr. LeBlanc. Same question.
I pretty much agree with both these guys here. It's the problem that we're having now is when a deputy goes out, I see deputies go out to cases and they interview the victim and they don't jot down one word. They don't write down one thing. They leave, and it's my understanding that they don't have to do the report for a number of days after. And then that report goes to narcotics or detectives, wherever, whoever the investigating unit in that organization would be. Well, if you don't have to do the report for 5 days and then they get it and it's 5 days later, some of these crimes you need to solve immediately. If it's a theft and 10 days later, 5 days later, whatever is stolen is gone. You're not going to find it. So they're not going to have the kind of evidence they need to get any kind of conviction. And I think that's a major part of the problem, is that things have to be done quicker. You can't put things off. You gotta investigate the crime. You gotta use all the tools and techniques you have, document it, put it together in a package that the DA's office can use. And if you don't do this, you're not going to get anything. If you're going to get the case thrown out, or you're not going to get a conviction, or you're going to get a lesser charge which carries almost nothing, and the guy will be back on the street in no time doing the same thing over again. That's the problem that we're having. We have the same people doing the same crime over and over again because we can't keep them locked up. We can't get them convicted. Well, that's really the problem with the sheriff's office. That's not the DA's office if they aren't getting the tools they need to convict these people. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Broussard, this next question goes to you first. How will you handle communications between departments within the sheriff's office, as well as communications between the deputies and the residents reporting a crime? And then secondly, in your opinion, what is a realistic response time on complaints? How long should it take for a complaint to get to a detective for investigation?
Every form of communication at present should be handled by what's called the ARM system. It's an electronic reporting system that channels reports through the process from a deputy to approving supervisor, then either into approval status for public access or for continued investigation. I'd like to think realistically every deputy taking a complaint from a resident provides the utmost respect and compassion that no matter how small the complaint is, that the deputy will be focused and willing to perform a thorough investigation to provide hopefully a peaceful long-term resolution to the problem. In addition, any victim involved in an investigative case will be contacted on a weekly basis, either one, to gather more information or to provide a status to that victim of their investigative case. I've also noticed most agencies offer an interactive criminal mapping system on the sheriff's website. This is absent on our sheriff's website. I feel this is a great public tool which allows residents to see where crimes are occurring in their communities, which also brings awareness to them and their surroundings.
Thank you. Mr. LeBlanc, same question. If you'd like, I will repeat it.
Yes, please.
How will you handle communication between departments within the sheriff's office, as well as communications between the deputies and the residents reporting a crime? And secondly, in your opinion, what is a realistic response time on complaints, and how long should it take for a complaint to get to a detective for investigation?
Again, this is pretty much parallels my answer in the last question. I don't understand why, especially with the modern conveniences we have, where the deputies can't do the reports by the end of their watch. I mean, when I was a deputy, we had to do all our reports before the end of our watch. And those reports went to the detectives or to narcotics or to the juvenile the next day. Now, when they got there, I'm sure they were prioritized by those offices, and the response time varied, I'm sure, depending on the severity of the crime and the load that they had. But in any case, I think the problem is on the front end. I think that the policies and procedures that they have don't force them to do these reports in a timely fashion. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Terrio, same question.
I think we need to streamline the upper management of the sheriff's office. Our office is top heavy. We have plenty of chiefs and not enough Indians. As far as the interaction between, if we streamline the upper management, it would allow for better communication between each division. There won't be as many people to go through to find out what's going on and how to go about doing it. As far as interaction between the deputies and the citizens, we'd add more patrol units to make smaller patrol areas where the deputies could become familiar with the residents and the businesses in the area, learn their areas, and residents would become more apt to speak to them when something goes wrong, and they could stop in, and people would be more willing to talk to them. Hold monthly public meetings in different areas of the parish so that the general public can come in and meet with the sheriff and the deputies that work that area. And again, to become familiar and trust, come to trust the department again with their safety. As far as the response time, the current patrol capabilities that the sheriff has, we got a 45-minute response time is what is coming from the public. That should be no more than about 10 minutes at most, and adding the more units to cover the areas will eliminate that problem.
Okay, thank you. And I want to pick up on that last and give the other candidates a chance to respond to that. In your opinion, what is a realistic response time? This would go to Mr. LeBlanc in the rural areas of the parish. Once a resident is dialed 911, how long do you think that resident should wait before there's a
I'm not sure what the measured response time that the sheriff's office here has now. I'll tell you, from sitting up here, 2 minutes is a long time. Yeah. But what I will say is that response time is number of deputies, time, and distance, which would equate to time. Whatever the response time now is, I'm understanding people are complaining in Orneville it's 45. I've got one complaint in Henderson where it was 3 days for a 911 call. I think whatever I do, I probably can do better than some of those. In any case, more deputies, shorter distances, maybe put some stations up in the places where they aren't, where the response time can be less. But there's whatever the response times are supposed to be, they're too high, and they can be reduced. There's no doubt in my mind.
Thank you. Mr. Broussard, same question?
The use of the 911 system through my years in law enforcement is used as a quick access number for both non-emergency and emergency calls. I like to see a deputy arriving at someone's residence for a non-emergency call within 10 minutes of the call originating. For emergency calls, I like to see a deputy there in less than 10 minutes. As Buzz has said, what people don't realize is what 10 minutes holds to somebody. This is a life or death situation. To a person hiding in a closet from a suspect, a person involved in a vehicle crash suffering from injuries, or a person who's suffering from a medical emergency, 10 minutes is their life. To every community that I've served in the past, I've patted myself on the back every shift. I was at your house in 8 minutes or under. I've been fortunate to save several individuals' lives, and that is one of the biggest things I'm going to bring to this parish, even if it means I leave my house and I do it myself.
Done. Mr. Terry, same question.
Response time, like I said, talking to the residents, I've heard people telling me 45 minutes. I've even had someone in the parks area who called for a lost child, and the deputy never even showed up. And he had to end up finding the parents himself and bring the child home. One of the things I would plan to do is utilize the fire districts as substations, placing areas where the deputies would be stationed and not leave their areas, which would give us a minimum of about 8 patrolmen throughout the parish. We would definitely cut down response times to any call. And talking about residences, this is something that they're really looking forward to, and hopefully we can win this election and get this done.
Okay, thank you. Next question, and I believe this goes to Mr. Terrio. The St. Martin Parish Sheriff's Office has leased the jail outside Brobridge to the state police. Does the jail in St. Martinville currently have enough capacity? If not, what plans do you have for housing offenders?
I was there when we built the jail in Brobridge. It housed 300 inmates. The jail in St. Martinville houses somewhere about 180. It's to full capacity all the time. Deputies can't even arrest people because they have no place to put them. As far as the jail in Brobridge, I would meet with the state representatives and whoever we need to try and regain use of the jail and reopen it and be able to house inmates there. When we had that jail there, we had trusty work crews who worked throughout the parish. We had somewhere around 11 or 12 crews who took care of our schools, our parks, our streets, all our public buildings, and all that has gone away with the closing of that building. That's something we need to bring back for the public. And if that doesn't work out, we have a juvenile center, which is again closed under this administration, sitting empty in St. Martinville, which could be, with some renovations, turned into an adult facility to be able to house inmates there. That'd be about the only way I can see to fix that problem.
Okay, Mr. Broussard, same question.
Unless major modifications have been performed in Hain Correctional in St. Martinville, cannot sustain the capacity that Boat Bridge withstood at one time. Because I've worked at both facilities. I actually started out here in Bro Bridge and moved on to St. Martinville in 2000 after the hostage situation. Bro Bridge at the time when I was there in 1995 held anywhere between 700 and 750 prisoners. All of them were state inmates. Majority of those inmates were work crews once used in our parish and cleanup efforts. I'm not against having a state police headquarters here in St. Martin Parish. However, I am against the fact that the closure of that facility has forced inmates serving time to be moved to overcrowded state facilities, forcing a parole board to grant early release, and cause families to endure hardships by traveling long distances to visit their loved ones who are incarcerated. I'm displeased with the closure of this specific correctional facility, as 90% of the work inmates from there were disbanded. This forces the municipalities and our parish government, along with the school board, to spend more taxpayer dollars and efforts to clean up the parish themselves, as I have personally witnessed this past year. As a resolution to housing offenders, I would thoroughly look at the lease agreement made with Louisiana State Police for this facility and the term of the lease agreement and reassess and evaluate the housing needs for a larger facility in the parish.
Thank you, Mr. LeBlanc, same question.
Well, I remember driving back from Lafayette one day and I couldn't believe my eyes when I saw a for sale sign out there. I said, what is going on? We can't do without this facility as a jail. In any case, a few weeks later, the sign was gone and the next thing we know, it's leased. It's leased to the state police. And again, I don't have a problem with the state police having office space in St. Martin Parish, but that lease goes to 2019. Unless some arrangement could be made where we could use a part of the building, or that lease could be vacated, I think we're probably out of that building until 2019. The facility in St. Martinville cannot house the number of prisoners that we need here. The facility that we had in Brobridge had trustees, work crews, it did training, it taught mechanics, it let them do woodworking, a multitude of things that you leave. You can go to the jockey lot here in Lafayette and still see ex-prisoners selling things that they learned how to make, they learned how to do while they're in jail, which they aren't going to get in the jail we have now. In any case, whatever we do, we have to get more jail space, whether it's going to adjacent parishes and working out some sort of deals with Lafayette, who just built a new facility, Iberia Parish, which it's an iffy thing. I mean, they'll let us put prisoners there, but if you put a guy there and then they need the space, they're going to make you take him out. And then what do you do with him? I'm so frustrated with this problem that I'm not against flying over to Arizona and talking to Sheriff Arpaio and finding out where he buys his tents. Because I'm sure there's somebody here would donate enough land where we could put some tents up to put these people in there until we get this problem straightened out. If it's good enough for people in the Army, Marines, it's good enough for our convicts. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. This next question goes to Mr. Broussard. Mr. Broussard, money in the sheriff's budget can vary from year to year, leading to the necessity to plan well or to triage. Do you think every crime reported should be reported and investigated?
Money in the budget does not affect the ability of an agency to investigate a criminal report or criminal activity. Commission personnel are being compensated to investigate and document every criminal report filed. I firmly believe every criminal act should be reported. That way law enforcement is made aware of the activity that has occurred and steps can be taken to prevent it from reoccurring and apprehend the person responsible for the acts that were committed. What's the second part to the question?
The second part to the question, money, it's about, should every crime be reported and investigated?
Yes.
Yes, okay, so you kind of finished. You turn to Mr. LeBlanc.
Yeah, every crime should be investigated. What, who's going to pick which ones aren't? And what are we going to base that decision on? Income? Severity of the crime? Whether you voted for me or not? Who's going to make the decision? This is completely wrong. Every crime needs to be investigated. You know, supposedly we're operating under a balanced budget now, but I get worried, you know, deputies are telling people, oh, we won't do a DNA sample because it costs too much. We won't, then the person says, well, I'm willing to pay for it, and they still won't do it. There's just something wrong. There's something wrong with the way we're doing business now. Every crime should be investigated. Every crime should be investigated to the fullest extent that the sheriff's office or the investigating agency could do. And you can work it into the budget. There's enough excess in these budgets where this shouldn't be a problem.
Okay, Mr. Terry, same question.
I have to agree with what both of them said. I mean, money shouldn't, and budget should have nothing to do with investigating any crimes. If there's a crime committed in this parish, it's the sheriff's job to investigate and arrest the offender. There's no guideline that says the sheriff is to choose what crimes are investigated and what is not. I mean, everyone calls in for a reason. They expect it to be taken care of, and it's not his job, any deputy's job, to choose, well, you know, there wasn't enough damage here, or it's not enough for us to investigate it. I personally ran into that offense when my business was broken into. Deputy, nothing was stolen, so he wouldn't even make the report. Asked him if he was going to take pictures and dust for prints, and he blatantly told me, he says, there's not enough of a crime here for us to investigate it. We don't have time for it. And that's where it was left, and he just walked away. That's not what the sheriff's office is there for. The sheriff's office is there to serve and protect the people, no matter what happens. And that's the way it will be.
Okay. Thank you. We move on to next question. I think this will be our last question before we move to statements at the end. This goes to Mr. LeBlanc first. What is your plan to stop or make accountable at least the chop shops in and around our parish so that the criminals will have no place to take stolen metals? Do you have a plan in place? Have you thought about something?
Well, On this question, I guess I associate chop shops more with stolen vehicles and that type of thing. And I'm not sure we have a big problem with that here. I'm not saying it doesn't exist, but I'm not aware of a big problem. As far as the stolen metals, you know, there's a few places here that buy stolen metals, and I from what I understand, they cooperate very, very well with the sheriff's office and the other police agencies in the area. You know, if somebody, if they're stealing metals here and they bring it across the parish line to some other place, unless you have some sort of agreements where they share your information, which I'm sure they do, I just don't know how effective they are. I don't think that's one of the bigger problems we're having here. I think property crimes and narcotics are a bigger threat than chop shops.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Terry.
I'm not aware that there's that much of a problem with that. I mean, I'm like Buzz. In my years with law enforcement, they talked about a chop shop. It was somebody stealing cars, stripping them, selling off parts. Stolen metals, it's not, to say, an issue that should be looked past. They need to be investigated. If we do have places that are doing this, they need to be investigated, charged, and brought to court, brought to justice. Work with the DA's office, surrounding agencies to, you know, combine our efforts and stop them.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Broussard?
Chop shops, they don't occur that often. And they do mostly pertain to automobiles, four-wheelers, tractors, etc. However, this parish suffers just like every parish with property crimes, which does deal with materials that are stolen from people's property and sold. In the past, through cooperative agreements with local scrap yards and law enforcement agencies, they are currently already monitoring the sale of these scrap metal. They assist with identification, apprehension of individuals selling the materials commonly stolen. As in the past, they provide a list of individuals who have sold this material once a month to your local law enforcement. And if I remember correctly, that list is also provided to the district attorney in at least one of the monthly meetings. Majority of scrap yards in Iberia Parish and Lafayette Parish do communicate to this date, and they already have a policy implemented for the sale of copper and radiators, which is number two copper, where not only are they identified, their photograph and their signature is obtained. If Simorin Parish doesn't have this in place, we're way behind. And it needs to be implemented with our sheriff's office. This is very valuable because I don't think any of us in this room today can go without air conditioning in this heat.
Okay, thank you. We now head to the closing statements. We're going to, you have about 3 minutes for your closing statement, and we're going to start with Mr. LeBlanc.
Okay, again, I'd like to thank everybody for being here. I'd like to thank the Brobridge City Council and the mayor for allowing the chamber to use the facility. It's a very nice facility, and it's cool. And again, thank you again for coming and supporting the forums. I hope that I answered your question satisfactorily. But I will say, if I did not, please call, because my campaign has an open-door policy. Furthermore, my sheriff's office will have an open-door policy. I'm here to restore your trust in law enforcement. We need a change in leadership, and we need it soon. We need this change in leadership to reduce major crimes, in particular, narcotics and property crimes. We need to ensure that crimes are properly investigated and that victims are kept informed of the status of those investigations. We need to increase the quality and quantity of our deputies. And we can accomplish this in part by increasing their pay. But most of all, we need to allow them to do the job that they were trained for in the way they were trained to do it. And we can do all this by reallocating the budget to eliminate the excesses that we all know exist. We see them. You drive around, you see them. Now, I feel that I'm uniquely qualified to be the sheriff with my experience in the military, law enforcement, and in business. And through this management and leadership experience that I have, I will restore your trust in law enforcement. And with your help, I will be the next sheriff of St. Martin Parish. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Terry. Mr. Terry?
As a citizen, I'm concerned. It's not a day goes by that we don't hear the sirens from the units running back and forth answering calls for, you know, crime or incident happen. It should concern everyone. If you're honoring me with your vote, the sheriff in the fall, I will make a solemn promise. First and foremost, as a native of this parish and a businessman, I have a vested interest in the future of St. Martin Parish and will do everything in my power to rid the parish of its criminal element. Second, I'm going to have an open door policy which will be open to the public 24/7. If anybody calls and needs, the department and myself will be available. There will be no saying I can't help you or he's not in. You will be answered. That we can discuss the problems, ongoing problems in your neighborhoods and your areas. Make people comfortable to come to law enforcement again. Restore the trust. We will keep up a website that will keep the public informed of what's going on within the department, in the neighborhoods, and in the parish. I'm going to end with a little quote from Abraham Lincoln. It says, "The government of the people, by the people, and for the people." You know, when was the last time you felt you had a voice within the parish law enforcement? When was the last time that you felt you could pick up the phone and discuss a problem with the sheriff's office? When was the last time you felt the parish sheriff's office was working for you? with me as your sheriff, I will restore that and be available to you at any time, both myself and the department. Thank you.
First off, I'd like to say all of us up here are uniquely qualified. We are. We speak of open door policy. We expect the people to come and meet us. I personally prefer to go to you. So if your door is open and you call, I will go to your house. Also, when's the last time you ever had a sheriff write a ticket? When's the last time you ever had a sheriff arrest someone? When's the last time you actually had a sheriff go out and handle a report instead of his deputy? That's the kind of person I am. And the last sheriff I saw is Louis Sackle. This parish has not seen that in a very, very long time. I'm looking to change that. If you expect to find me in the office once elected, you got the first 3 hours of the morning. After that, just call. I'll be more than happy to go to your house any time of the day or night, 7 days a week. If there's any questions anyone has they'd like to ask, I'm available at any given point of the time, and every question will be answered and every problem will be solved. There will be no more, I cannot help anyone.
Okay, I'd like to thank the candidates for coming tonight and letting you know what their views are like. I'd like to thank you for coming and being a part of this democracy, great democracy that we have, and doing what's important for your community. And I encourage you to help others understand the issues in this race and introduce them to the candidates that you've seen tonight. Thanks to Rick Pearson, who is helping to put this together into the council here. So thank you very much. Good night. Thank you.